sir. How you doing?
Good.
I'm Danny. I won't remember that long, but my memory is better.
Join the club.
How are you?
Amen. Girls? Good to have y'all in church. Good morning. And how are you doing?
Good morning, Trinity. Oh, try that again. That was kind of, I know it's hot, y'all, but we can do this. Good morning, Trinity. There we go. It is a beautiful day to be in the house of the Lord, isn't it? Yes. All right. So if you would turn to the back part of your bulletin, we have several announcements for your review. First of all, welcome to Pastor Julie Bellman and her family. Yes. Amen to that. We had a glorious welcome brunch last week. There was truly enough food to feed Pharaoh's army, and it was all delicious. Special thanks to Pamela Wood and her team for coordinating that, because it takes a village to make these things happen, y'all. And as part of our additional welcome to Julie Bellman, we do have a presentation from the worship committee. If Kim Conant would come forward, please.
All right, Reverend Julie. A little birdie told us that you like pink. And Starbucks is one of your favorite places
yes,
to buy coffee.
It is.
And woman after my own heart, your favorite candy is peanut butter M&M's. And there you go. We got the family size.
Oh my God.
So this, my dear, is for you and your family to enjoy.
Thank
and
you.
We're just so happy that you're here.
What a delight. I'm so glad to be with you.
Yeah.
Oh, thank you. That's gorgeous.
I was going to say, if you leave that
should
up
just
there,
take it with me.
Yeah. Part of it might get gone. Some other announcements. Our Salkehatchie campers finished up last week. Many thanks to those of you who provided water, food, snacks, who prayed for them. It's my understanding that everybody survived the heat. And Bonnie's over here going, yes, yes, God, we survived. So, yay, thank you for that. Couple of other things. Our classic adults, I like that term, classic adults are planning a trip to McLeod Farms up in McBee, and that is how that is pronounced. It's not McBee, it's McBee, South Carolina, and there will be peaches involved. If you have any questions or want to participate in that trip, please see Gary Bader. Gary, raise your hand in case nobody knows who that is. That's Gary in the back. Talk to Gary. Summer Splash. Whew, anything to cool off. Summer Splash is in August. Now, that sounds like a long way away, August 25th. But, y'all, today is July 7th. July 7th. Mark it down, adults, kids. It'll be a fun time for everybody. And last but not least, guess what happens 1 week from today? Vacation Bible School from the choir. Yay, not the choir Vacation Bible School, but Vacation Bible School. Bonnie Riley, raise your hand. Do you still need volunteers? All right, so she needs helpers. One night, every night, an hour, 2 hours, whatever. Show up. It's going to be great. Campfire Light is going to be is the theme for this. And the scripture, if I can find it on here, which I should know already, is whenever I'm afraid, I put my trust in you. So that is something that we all can remember, that when we're afraid, we can always go to the Lord and trust in the Lord. And with that, let us go to the Lord in prayer. Almighty God, we thank you for the privilege of being able to gather and worship in your presence. Help us in every situation, the good, the bad, the in-between, remember that you are with us every single step of the way, and we do indeed put our trust in you. Amen. Let us worship God.
Good morning. Please remain standing as we continue our worship with a responsive greeting printed in the bulletin or on the screen. Your part is in bold. Our God is a God of power and strength. Our God is a God of majesty and awe. Our God is a God of glory and wonder.
God loves each of us with tenderness and passion.
Our God calls us each by name.
God calls each of us to unite in worship together.
Please be seated. If you'll join me in the prayer for illumination in your bulletin and on the screen, let us pray together. Gracious God, as we turn to your word for us, may the Spirit of God rest upon us. Help us to be steadfast in our hearing, in our speaking, in our believing, and in our living. Amen. Our Old Testament reading is Isaiah 43, 1 through 7, also printed in your bulletin and on the screen. We'll read this responsively, and again, your part is in bold. But now thus says the Lord, he who created you, O Jacob, he who formed you.
O Israel, do not fear, for I have redeemed you. I have called you by name, you are mine.
When you pass through the waters, I will be with you.
And through the rivers, they shall not overwhelm you.
When you walk through fire, you shall not be burned, and the flame shall not consume you. Because you are precious in my sight and honored, and I love you, I give people in return for you, nations in exchange for your life.
Do not fear, for I am with you. I will bring your offspring from the east, and from the west I will gather you.
I will say to the north, give them up, and to the south, do not withhold. Bring my sons from far away and my daughters from the end of the earth. May God help us apply these words to our lives.
Can I have the children come forward? Good morning. Good morning, good morning. So I want you all to think about, who are you? Who are you? Okay. Yeah, you're kids, right? But Pastor Julie is going to talk about who we are. Have you heard the word identity? You may have heard of identity thieves or a stolen identity. But identity means kind of who you are. So let me tell you about my identity. I'm a girl. I'm a mom. I'm a daughter. I'm a wife. I don't have any brothers or sisters, so I can't say I'm a sister. I was an only child. Way back, a long time ago, I was a swimmer. I swam for my high school, right? I like to think I'm pretty silly, right? I can be pretty silly. I like to think I'm caring. I can be ornery too, though, and I can be real stubborn. So your identity is who you are, right? So your students, right? You all go to school. Your children of your family. Maybe you are a softball player or a soccer player. What are you? You're a taekwondo. Wow. You do dance. What's something you all do? Gymnastics. Gymnastics, too. I was a gymnast when I was little. And there's things that, right, I'm not really a gymnast now. I cannot call myself a gymnast now. Although I can still do a cartwheel, just saying. But I can't say I'm a gymnast now. I used to be a gymnast. I used to be a competitive swimmer. I used to be a student in school, right? So some things we grow out of, and they're not really part of our identity. But there's one thing about our identity that never, ever, ever, ever changes. And that is that we, all of us, you guys, everybody in this room, everybody in the whole world, is a child of God. No matter how old we are, no matter how grown up and important we get, we're still God's children. And what does that mean? That means He loves us no matter what. That means He cares about us. He hears us. He sees us. He knows us. He knows how many hairs are on my head and how many are going to fall out today. Because they will, right? Everybody loses hair. He knows how many freckles I have on my face. And He knows all that stuff about you all, too. And we may feel like we don't know very much about God, but the cool part is He doesn't really worry about how much we know about Him. He wants us to love Him. He wants us to feel like we're part of His family. So the most important part of your identity, no matter what you are right now, no matter what you grow up to be, which, by the way, God already knows what you're going to do when you grow up, just saying, is that you're His child, and He loves you so much more than we can even wrap our brains around. I can't even imagine how much God loves me. So that's the most important part of your identity. Yeah, you can be a dancer and a gymnast and do taekwondo, but most importantly is that you are a child of God. That's what I always hope you remember more than anything else, is that you're a child of God and He loves you so much. Let's pray. Thank you, God, for your love. Help us share your love. Amen. And you can go to Children's Church with Miss Kaler.
Good morning, my friends. It's so good to be with you today. I am the Reverend Julie Songer Bellman. If we have not yet met, I look forward to getting to know you. You can just call me Pastor Julie. Trinity certainly has an identity of a people who know how to welcome and to love. Thank you for all of the warm welcome you have shown to me and my family. I thought last week's SPRC gift of a spa day and Chick-fil-A for my children was pretty good, and now I can't wait to enjoy this basket full of my favorite things. Thank you for welcoming me and my family here. We're excited to partner with you in the good work that God is doing here at Trinity. Our scripture lesson today comes from the Gospel of Luke, the third chapter, beginning with the 21st verse. Hear these words. Now, when all the people were baptized, and when Jesus had been baptized, the heaven was opened up, and the Holy Spirit descended upon him like a dove. And a voice came from heaven, saying, "You are my Son, my beloved. With you I am well pleased." This is the word of God for us, the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
And we give thanks to God for it. So I wonder if, looking at my sermon title, 24601, you have any idea where I'm going this morning? It's not a zip code. You Googled it? I think it is a zip code for something. It's not a Bible verse. Instead, it is a reference to a French historical novel, Les Miserables. Les Miserables is the story of redemption. It's about an unlikely character who finds his way, a 19th century peasant, and his quest for redemption. You should know that my father took me to New York City on my 10th birthday, and our very first night in New York, we saw Les Miserables on Broadway. That was the night that I returned to the hotel room, called my mother long distance on the telephone, and told her if she ever wanted to see me again, she would have to move to New York, because I was never coming home. And to be fair, I did move to New York many years later and enjoy a season there. As the story of Les Miserables begins, we see an incarcerated man being released from prison. Everyone refers to this person as 24601. He has no name, no identity, other than the one the prison system has given to him. We see 24601 struggling to find a job and community, just like many formerly incarcerated men do today. Seeing his desperation, a kind priest invites 24601 to have dinner and stay the night at his parsonage. 24601 takes advantage of this kindness and tries to sneak off in the middle of the night with a bag full of silverware and valuables. But he is caught by the police, who bring him back to the priest. The priest then, however, insists that he gave these items to 24601, and not only that, that his special guest had left without the most precious items. And the priest presses 24601 to accept some silver candlesticks as well. And as 24601 is about to walk out the door, the priest whispers to him, "My son, you must use this silver to become an honest man. By the witness of the martyrs, by the passion and the blood, God has raised you out of darkness. I have bought your soul for God." In light of the priest's kindness and grace, 24601 wonders about his identity, who he really is, and what he could possibly become. He sings a song called "Who Am I?" asking if he is really a beast, as the prison system and society have pegged him. Or is he a man worthy of dignity, of food, of shelter, of trust, as the priest's actions would indicate? In this moment, he resolves to give up the identity of 24601 and live into this new role the priest has offered him. He rips up his parole certificate and reclaims the name from his birth, Jean Valjean. He flees to a nearby town and ends up remaking his life. I won't tell you the entire story, although I truly love it. Highly recommend, if you're not in the mood for thousands of pages of French literature, there are several wonderful movie adaptations of Les Mis as well. But the story of Jean Valjean brings up something I'd like us to consider today. Who are you? Like Bonnie, ask our children, who are you? Not any title or degree or job, not a passion or a vocation, but who are you? Who are we besides the numbers in our bank account or our driver's license and other documents? What makes us who we are? You might have noticed that every particular preacher has his or her particular biases about what the core truths and non-negotiables of faith might be. And these ideas surface again and again in our preaching, no matter what the biblical text might be. So I thought in our first Sunday together, you might be interested in knowing what some of these are for me. For me, a big one is the question of identity. Who am I? Who are you? Les Miserables, like all good works of art, raises questions about what really matter in life. Questions about identity, who we are, what our purpose is, why we are here, to what and to whom we belong. Of course, Scripture also raises these same questions. 2 for 1 ask, who am I? Who am I? He says, can I conceal myself forevermore, pretend I'm not the man I was before, and must my name until I die be no more than an alibi? Who am I? 2, 4, 6, 0, 1. What is your answer to that question? Are you a sister, former gymnast, swimmer, a Republican, master gardener, allergic to peanuts? My short answer would be, I am a reverend mother who gives herself fully to people and relationships, who loves peanut butter M&Ms, Starbucks coffee, and good conversation. Who or what determines who you are? What specific people or events or choices along the way have made you the person that you are today? To who and what do you belong? These are deep, significant spiritual questions and worth exploring. And I find that in the life of faith, this kind of wondering leads us to a central truth, that we find our identity in Jesus Christ. In today's Old Testament reading, we hear God's long-ago promises recorded through the prophet Isaiah, saying, "Do not be afraid, for I have redeemed you. I have called you by name. You are mine." Faith in Christ teaches us who we are, God's beloved children. We have the promise of God's unconditional regard. Whatever else determines who we are, we have this assurance. And in our baptisms, we are claimed with God's love. We know who we are because we know whose we are. We are God's beloved children. We belong to God's family. Baptism is a tangible sign of this inward and spiritual grace. And I think it's worth noticing that even Jesus gets, maybe even Jesus needs, this kind of affirmation. At his baptism, the voice that comes from heaven speaks to Jesus personally. God says, you are my beloved. You are mine. I know you by name. Coming up from the waters of baptism, Jesus humbles himself. He He identifies with us. It is this decisive moment as the identity of Christ is revealed. As he is baptized, his true identity is revealed to us. And all throughout his ministry, Jesus will define himself by that identity. It will be the basis for all the choices he makes. It will be the thing that guides him when all other voices in the world try to pull him down another path. In the New Testament, the Gospels move from baptism to the temptation of Christ to the inauguration of his mission and ministry on earth. Jesus goes from this moment preaching the good news that the kingdom of God has come near. The message of Jesus was an outflow from his identity. He knew who he was and why he had come, what he needed to do and say. That message never wavered. Who am I? Who are we? When we ask these questions in church, for me, they cannot be separated from the question of who is God. Now, if we've had any kind of Christian formation, Sunday school, connection time, Bible study, we know we are children of the divine creator, made in God's image, a chip off the old block. But it has amazed me in ministry how many people really don't believe this. They don't believe that they are loved unconditionally. They don't believe that they are intended for good, that God is for them. They don't believe that God pours out forgiveness and grace with reckless abandon. Do you believe it? My friends, hear the good news. All of us are made in God's image, loved and forgiven. Amen. You will notice in my ministry that this theme will continue to arise, that I will emphasize a God who embodies real love. I will remind you that each and every one of us bears the image of God, that we are named and claimed and meant for God's purposes in the world. I find evidence of this all throughout the scriptures, from Genesis to Revelation. In Les Miserables, the priest redeemed the life of convict 24601 by not handing him over for imprisonment, by refusing to acknowledge that he had stolen the silver. This man of God was showing with his life that mercy really mattered, that what he taught in the church and how he lived really matched up. And from that moment, 24601 was claimed for God's glory. This meant that he lived differently. He loved differently. He treated people differently. Like the priest, 24601 went into the redemption business. The rest of the story flows, and we see this ex-criminal keeping a promise to a dying prostitute, literally buying the freedom of her daughter Cosette, caring for Cosette as if she were his own flesh and blood, praying for and going to rescue Cosette's love, Marius, from the throes of war. We even see 24601 setting free his nemesis, the prison guard Javert. Time and time again, 24601 shows us who he really is. And God gets the glory. When he sings the final reprise of "Who Am I?" he says, "My soul belongs to God, I know. I made this promise long ago. He gave me hope when hope was gone. He gave me strength to carry on. Who am I? I'm Jean Valjean." My friends, do you know what that is? That is the song of someone who has heard and understood the truth of God's word. the truth that the prophet Isaiah spoke, saying, "Fear not, for I have redeemed you. I have called you by name. You are mine." As we come to the table of grace this morning, I hope each of you will hear God whispering your name today. Brenda, you are my beloved. Jason, I have called you by name. Frank, this is my body given for you. Mary Payton, this is my blood poured out in love for you. Mother, father, brother, sister, younger and older, you are mine. Who am I? Who are we? A beloved child, the body of Christ. Thanks be to God. Let us pray. Holy and gracious Lord, we have gathered today to worship and praise you, the God of majesty and awe. We have come to encounter the risen Lord in our midst, the one who knows each of us by name and who walks with us in intimate love. We have come to reaffirm the blessings we received in our baptism. Through your word proclaimed this day, we remember Christ's saving actions throughout history. And we are given the chance to answer yes as God whispers our names. Help us. Lead us, Lord of love. Our bodies and souls hunger for your spirit. We thank you for offering us grace in the simple gifts of bread and wine. Grace that satisfies our deepest hunger and quenches our deepest thirst. Open our hearts this day to receive the bread of life and the cup of salvation, that we may become your faithful disciples. It is in Jesus' holy name that we pray. Amen. Amen. My friends, at this time I invite you to stand as you are able and join me as we profess our faith with the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he rose from the dead, he ascended into heaven, and sitteth at the right hand of God, the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, friends, it is with joy that we give to God our tithes and offerings today. As our ushers come forward, I invite you to give with joy in the Lord. Thank you.
gracious and wonderful Father, we thank you for the gift of this day, for each and every opportunity we have to join in your work of kingdom. Pour out your blessings upon us and all that we offer to you today. May it be used for your glory. We pray in Christ's holy name. Amen. My friends, as we prepare to come to the table this morning, I invite you to join me in the confession and pardon. Christ our Lord invites to his table all who love him, who earnestly repent of their sin and seek to live in peace with one another. Therefore, let us confess our sin before God and one another. Merciful God, we confess that we have not loved you with our whole heart. We have failed to be an obedient church. We have not done your will. We have broken your law. We have rebelled against your love. We have not loved our neighbors, and we have not heard the cry of the needy. Forgive us, we pray. Free us for joyful obedience through Jesus Christ our Lord. Hear the good news. Christ died for us while we were yet sinners. That proves God's love toward us. In the name of Jesus Christ, you are forgiven.
In the name of Jesus Christ, you are forgiven.
Glory to God. Amen and amen.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
It is right and a good and joyful thing, always and everywhere, to give thanks to you, Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth. You formed us in your image and breathed into us the breath of life. When we turned away and our love failed, your love remained steadfast. You delivered us from captivity, made covenant to be our sovereign God, and spoke to us through your prophets, who look for that day when justice shall roll down like waters and righteousness like an ever-flowing stream, when nation shall not lift up sword against nation, neither shall they learn war anymore. And so with your people on earth and all the company of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn.
Holy, holy.
Holy are you, and blessed is your Son, Jesus Christ. Your Spirit anointed him to preach good news to the poor, to proclaim release to the captives, and recovering of sight to the blind, to set at liberty those who are oppressed, and to announce that the time had come when you would save your people. He healed the sick, fed the hungry, and ate with sinners. By the baptism of his suffering, death, and resurrection, you gave birth to your church, delivered us from slavery to sin and death, and made with us a new covenant by water and the Spirit. At his ascension, you exalted him to sit and reign with you at your right hand. On the night in which he gave himself up for us, he took bread, gave thanks to you, broke the bread, gave it to his disciples, and said, "Take, eat, this is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." When the supper was over, he took the cup, gave thanks to you, gave it to his disciples, and said, "Drink from this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." And so, in remembrance of these your mighty acts in Jesus Christ, we offer ourselves in praise and thanksgiving as a holy and living sacrifice in union with Christ's offering for us as we proclaim the mystery of faith.
Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again.
Pour Pour out your Holy Spirit on us gathered here and on these gifts of bread and wine. Make them be for us the body and blood of Christ, that we may be for the world the body of Christ, redeemed by his blood. By your Spirit, make us one with Christ, one with each other, and one in ministry to all the world, until Christ comes in final victory and we feast at his heavenly banquet. Through your Son, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit and your Holy Church, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever. Amen. And now, with the confidence of children, let us pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses. As we are one body and this is one loaf, we share in the breaking, the eating, and the living, the body of Christ. And as we are one body and this is one cup, we share in the drinking of the blood of Christ. All are welcome to the table today. We receive communion by intinction, so you'll receive the bread, you'll dip it into the chalice. If you would like prepackaged, we will have those elements, both regular and gluten-free. We'll also have a gluten-free station, which will be in the middle. The other two stations are on either side of the altar here. Ushers will guide you from which section you're going to come to receive. So all are welcome to receive this gift of grace today. Let me go ahead and have our servers come forward at this time.
My friends, let us pray. Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, we thank you for this holy mystery in which you have given yourself to us. So fill us with your Spirit and change us for your purposes, that we might be used in the world for your glory. In Christ's holy name we pray. Amen. My friends, I invite you to stand as you are able and join in our closing hymn. It's number 634. Now from this table, let us rise. Claimed now and forever as his beloved. Go from this place in the knowledge and truth that God is always with you. Amen.